Hey, everyone. I'm Andy. I'm from a company called Feature, which I'll introduce in a second. And yeah, today I'm going to talk a little bit about push notifications and present just a way of thinking about how to look at push notifications when you're thinking about designing those and implementing those to prioritize the ones that are likely to drive the most impact. So this is us. This is Feature. It's myself and Moritz. Formed Feature last year. We're both ex-SoundCloud growth people, so I used to run the retention team at SoundCloud. And actually, a lot of what I'm going to present today is based on my experience there building a real-time activity notification service at SoundCloud that was sending, still is sending, I guess, hundreds of millions of notifications per week. So I'll be presenting like some of what I learned from that experience, as well as some of the experience more recently with some of our other clients at Feature. So this is like some of the clients that we work with. What we do is we help apps grow. We help companies to build a holistic growth strategy using a framework which we call the mobile growth stack. So this is the mobile growth stack. I'm not going to talk you through that today. You can read more about it at mobilegrowthstack.com. But the highlighted areas are the areas of the stack that this most relates to. So activity notifications, typically programmatically generated, although you can also generate notifications from dashboard tools from like marketing automation services as well, such as like AppBoy, Lean Plum, Localytics. So yeah, really I'm sort of focusing on this push notifications channel and activity notifications, typically to drive engagement or retention. So talking here about growth-centric notifications as opposed to maybe more functional notifications such as like a password reset email or something like this. So yeah, just speaking about push, push works. Hopefully that isn't a point that I need to really like labor on. They definitely do drive more engagement, drive more retention, and can also help to reactivate users. Basically, a push notification, it's a way of like bringing people back into the app to drive some engagement. But you better have something useful to say if you're sending a push notification, because it's pretty invasive, right? It's like it's a bit like coming up to someone and tapping them on the shoulder. If you're going to do that, they'll turn around and they'll listen at least the first couple of times. But you better have something important or interesting and relevant to say. Otherwise, you know, probably at some point they're going to get annoyed with you. And in the case of push notifications, that means they'll turn them off, or maybe they'll deinstall the app altogether. OK, it's kind of a busy slide, but this is kind of an ideal scenario for like a push activity notification service that would deliver notifications over push, but maybe also other channels such as email or an in-house client notifications feed. This is just a, like an abstraction to sort of conceptualize like what a decent push notification service is really doing. So this is an example from music streaming. So basically, you've got a whole bunch of like internal signals. It's essentially a signal processing like system, basically. You've got a whole bunch of things happening in the outside world or within the context of the platform that you might want to notify certain users about. And so in the case of a music streaming service, that might be things like new content being uploaded to the platform. Could be social signals, such as like somebody's followed a user on the platform, or things that have like happened to content. So it could be like something's been added to a playlist, for example, in the case of music, or something's been listened to. So these are all like potential triggers that could develop, could trigger a notification. And then this kind of part in the middle is really like matching these signals to users who might want to hear about them. And yeah, you can basically build that to an infinite level of complexity, but you can start off pretty simple and sort of add additional functionality over time. But like ultimately, it's matching things that are happening to users who might want to know about them, and then spitting them out over a delivery layer, depending on those users' notifications preferences, which might include that they want to hear it by email, might be push, or it might be an in-app client notifications feed, or it could be something like SMS. So this is basically the kind of core message that I want to get across today. And that's your impact. Like, and when I define impact, I'm really talking about sort of growth metrics. Ultimately, like whatever kind of engagement you're trying to drive, that's your impact. Your impact is influenced by three things when it comes to sending notifications. It's the reach, the relevance of the notification, and the frequency of which you're able to send that particular notification type. And those three things combined will like influence your overall impact or the overall potential of that notification to drive growth for you. So let's talk about a bit about reach. If I'm sending a direct message to someone, Yeah, like, so for example, WhatsApp, great example, sends tons and tons of direct messages, one-to-one messages, which you have a reach of one. So I send a message to Ville here, for example, and yeah, it's got a reach of one, which is, you know, relatively limited impact, but the relevancy couldn't be higher. You know, I'm sending a direct message. He's probably going to open it. I hope so, anyway. You know, that relevancy is really high, and, you know, a platform like WhatsApp that's built around communication actually drives, like, so much impact with push notifications simply because they can also be really high on frequency, because that there's so much interaction happening on that platform. The relevance is really high, the frequency is really high, so they don't need, like, a ton of reach with these notifications. It's slightly higher for a group message. But then, yeah, things like a Facebook status update is going to reach maybe hundreds of people, depending on how many friends you have. And yeah, like some of the platforms like Instagram, you know, some people have millions and millions of followers on that. So if they post something, it, you know, the notification potential there is really high. Like there's potentially millions of people that would be, you know, reached and and impacted by that notification. It's the same with like SoundCloud, for example, our new track notification. If Drake uploads a new track, then millions of followers get a notification about it, or at least qualify for that notification. I'll talk a bit about that in a minute. So in terms of relevance, the best thing you can do is make things like as personalized as possible. A lot of this can be done programmatically. So relevance can mean, you know, personalization can mean a lot of different things. It can be looking at implicit or explicit signals that the user has given you in terms of what they're actually interested in. If you're able to ask the user, oh, hey, are you interested in this, this, and this? And they say, yes, I am, then of course it's very easy to personalize on that stuff. It gets a little trickier if you're using implicit signals, like just looking at their usage history to try and understand their tastes and preferences a bit more organically. But that's also a great way to improve the relevance. And yeah, that's something which you can sort of spend a lot of time sort of improving those algorithms. But also things like just like making sure that you're sending the message in the right time zone and the right user's right language, and just simple things like using the username, things like that, can really help to improve the relevance. And anything social is really helpful. So like anything where somebody's directly interacting with the user or interacting with something the user has posted, people like to hear about stuff which directly affects them, or, you know, like a lot of ego-driven stuff. So, you know, if I've uploaded a photo or made a comment on a thread and then someone replies to it, I want to hear about it. So all of these things can, yeah, increase relevancy. And then frequency, I think, is like a really important one, which is often overlooked when people are thinking about which kinds of notifications to build. Often frequency is not really considered. And definitely in the SoundCloud's case, this is sort of one, I wouldn't call it a mistake exactly, but definitely like a big learning that we had. We built a whole bunch of notifications as our kind of initial set that we launched. And then we were really surprised, actually, because we didn't really think this through and I didn't sort of have this model in my head when we designed these notifications, I was really surprised like how little the new playlist notification was, you know, driving impact, and it was how few of them were being sent actually compared to the new track notification. But actually it's pretty obvious, you know, when I really thought about it, is actually there are millions and millions of new tracks being uploaded to SoundCloud, like, you know, every week. And so there's millions of those events hitting that activity notification system, whereas actually playlist creation activity on SoundCloud, it's a much smaller subset of users. It's kind of a power user feature, if you like. It's not really a power user feature, but still, there's a lot fewer users who are creating playlists than there are tracks hitting the system. So the number of like input signals is much lower, and as such, the potential for generating notifications is much lower. So yeah, the new track notification was much higher impact, even though the relevancy was actually maybe a little less. So I put together this colorful 2x2 matrix just to with celestial themes, just to sort of help sort of make it a bit simpler to kind of conceptualize the different kinds of notifications that you probably have in your system and to think about like which ones are going to have the highest impact. So I'll start off with stars and kind of go around in a clockwise. So think about stars. There are millions of stars in the sky, so it's like they're high frequency. And everyone can see them. You just go outside, presuming there's not enough light, there's no light pollution, and you can actually see the stars. It's not a cloudy day. Likely, you'll see a lot of stars a lot of the time. So these are like high reach and high frequency. And a great example of a high reach, high frequency notification would be something like there's new content. So In SoundCloud's case, you know, new tracks hitting the platform from people I follow. You can generate a lot of notifications with these, and hence these are great notifications to have. Then moving on to the high reach, low frequency, the full moons. So a full moon, you see a full moon 12 times a year, right? If you go outside at the right time. So they're not like massively infrequent, but they happen now and again. They generally, you know, have fairly strong impact and relevance, these kind of notifications. Could be something like an occasional sale alert, for example, something where you wouldn't want to overdo it. If you increase the frequency too much on these ones, you know, you might actually find that the impact goes down because the relevancy, you know, people start to find them irrelevant. But if they're like infrequent but somewhat interesting and valuable, they can be a strong addition to the mix. Then you've got the eclipses, these like low reach and low frequency. So these are, I think, like the least valuable from a growth point of view because it's really hard to drive like significant engagement on like a large scale with these eclipses. So like you see an eclipse very rarely in real life, right? Coming back to the celestial analogy. And yeah, so in the example of a product, these are things which they're generally actually some of the most valuable notifications for the user because they're sort of something very specific. So the example I've got here is your flight X whatever, which you know your flight booking app knows that you're checked in on. And it's telling you it's delayed by 2 hours. So maybe it saves you a trip to the airport or it saves you a lot of waiting around because you know your flight's delayed. It's super valuable for the user. But probably like on a grand scheme of things, not too many users are going to be notified about flight delays, hopefully anyway. So it's maybe a very valuable product feature, but it's not really a growth notification. And then finally, like the Northern Lights. So these are, you know, the Northern Lights in real life, they actually happen pretty frequently, but only people in like certain parts of the world can see them. You have to be like really close to the northern or southern hemisphere. Well, the northern hemisphere for the Northern Lights. I think they have something similar in the south. So to see this, you can see it fairly frequently, but only like a subset of the population sees it. So these are what I would call like kind of power user features, power user notifications. These can be great for kind of keeping engaged, like the people that are already pretty engaged with the product, but they're not really going to necessarily onboard new users or have like as much impact as notifications in the stars quadrant. So a good example of this would be Facebook page admin notifications. I have a Facebook page. I get told when I have new likes on it, new comments on the posts on this. It's like a business page, but most people don't have a business page on Facebook. They just have their personal profile. So most people never see these admin notifications. Okay, so I'm going to hurry up a little bit because I only got 2 minutes left. optimizing impact, yeah. I'd say if you're going to prioritize for anything, prioritize for reach, because then you have like the maximum, like, the maximum potential. I think it's easier to like if you pick a notification that's likely to be relevant for like the whole audience, and you have that like high reach, you can always improve relevance a little bit anyway by, you know, testing around with copy, emojis, this kind of thing. You can improve the CTR from its baseline. But it's hard to increase reach on a notification which is, you know, only targeted at power users or people that use a certain feature. You might be able to increase frequency over time as well by looking at like implicit signals rather than expecting the user to explicitly say, I want to be notified about this. The smarter your system can be at identifying users who probably want to be notified on this based on their past behavior or perhaps their past engagement with notifications, then you can start to increase that frequency on those users too, and that will also increase your impact. So really quickly, some examples. Medium, I think, does a great job. This is a great example of a star notification. I get 2 of these per day. It's recommending me content based on my previous listening experience. Super relevant, works great. Kayak price alerts, they're very high relevance, but they happen very rarely, at least like for me, because I don't book many flights on Kayak. It's kind of a power user feature, so it's like a Northern Light. Waze gives you like alerts when there are traffic works or you know this is like a shutdown on an interstate. This particular example would happen hopefully very rarely. It's not really that great if they close the motorway, but it's very, very useful. And we'll call that an eclipse. It's more of a product feature. And a sale alert from ASOS. I might well want to go out and buy some new clothes. But if they're telling me like all the time there's a sale every week, you know, then that relevance will go down. So they have to be careful with like increasing the frequency there. So quick recap. impact equals reach times relevance times frequency. And it's easier to improve relevance and frequency a little bit if you have a high reach notification. It's harder to increase reach later. But think about creating a nice mix of these notifications. And be careful also to measure for negative effects, such as push opt-outs, deinstalls, things like that, to make sure that you're on the right track when you're building these notifications. And that's it from me. You can read more about this stuff at these websites.
Thank you very much, Andy. Thank you very much.
Thanks.